Hey there, it's Rachel Mullins, the host of Hashtag No Filter Fridays on Public House Media.
This is Sam Kirby, host of Cinema Stories here on Public House Media. Thanks for listening to the following broadcast on Public House Media. Once you're done with this episode, I hope you'll come check out my show, Cinema Stories, where we hang out and just talk movie and TV news and reviews, and it's awesome. A new show comes out every single Tuesday. Don't forget to subscribe on iTunes so you never miss an episode of Cinema Stories. Thanks again for checking out the following broadcast on Public House Media.
Welcome to Loud and Proud. This is a show all about disability, by disability, and for disability. As always, thanks to Public House Media for providing us with this platform. I am your host, Nicole Kelly. I myself was born with just one hand and have spent the past few years traveling the country, speaking at schools and universities about the topic of disability. Do you live with a disability? If so, hello and welcome to a place where you can get connected with experts in our community, find thought leaders who are making changes and speaking out. Remember to hit subscribe as you will want this reminder every Monday night when Loud and Proud goes live on Facebook. And for those of you who are listening, be sure to hit that subscribe button on your app because obviously you're going to want to hang out with us next week too. Remember, feel free to actually share this if anything I say or my guest says actually resonates with you. The goal of the show is simply to educate. And the more people who watch, the more people we educate through the awesome power of conversation. So with all of that being said, let's get to the actual guest of the evening, the star of the show tonight. She is the Senior Director of Communications at the Columbia Lighthouse for the Blind. Please welcome Miss Jocelyn Hunter to our show tonight. Welcome, Jocelyn.
Oh, thank you, Nicole. I'm glad to be here with you. Thank you for thinking of me and Columbia Lighthouse for the Blind. Long time no see.
That's right. It's been a while since we've hung out together. Can you tell folks where you are and a little bit about Columbia Lighthouse for the Blind?
Absolutely. So tonight I am in Washington, D.C., Columbia Lighthouse for the Blind. We're headquartered in the nation's capital. We serve the entire region, which includes Northern Virginia, the District of Columbia, and most of the state of Maryland, Prince George's and Montgomery counties in the state of Maryland. And we are a service provider committed to serving people of all ages who are blind, visually impaired, and deafblind, overcome the challenges of vision loss so that they can remain just as productive and independent in the community as people without vision loss. And we've been around doing this for 117 years now.
Oh my gosh, has it seriously been that long?
It sure has. Yeah, it'll be 118 come May.
That's amazing. Before we went live, you were telling me about a trip you just took. Can you tell us about that?
Yeah, so this past Saturday, thanks to a donor, we went up to Liberty Mountain in Pennsylvania. We hosted a ski trip for a dozen of our adult clients. And it was a remarkable time. It was beautiful weather. We had a couple of volunteer guides per client, and the volunteers were provided from the adaptive program up in Pennsylvania. And we also invited a group of our volunteers to join us, a group of volunteers from Georgetown's graduate physiology program. And yeah, it was wonderful. The group participated in two really extensive lessons of skiing, and it was a great time. This is the third year we've had it, although we didn't officially go last year because it was such a mild winter.
But there was no snow.
Yeah, it kicked off in 2016, and we were able to return this year. So yeah, we had a fabulous time. It was a great getaway. And yeah, our hats off to our donor who approached us about it a couple of years ago This gentleman is an avid skier, and he was skiing out west once, and he saw an individual with vision loss skiing, and he was so touched and inspired by it. He approached our CEO about it, and our CEO, Tony, accepted the offer, and here we are. Yeah, we just finished another trip on the slopes.
How fun is that?
Yeah.
I am wondering logistically when, where is the guide when they're with the person skiing? Are they beside them? They're not in front of them, right? How does that
right.
work?
Right. So in this particular instance, up at Liberty Mountain, the individual who's learning to ski is in the center, and mm-hmm. on each side is a guide.
Oh, there's two.
Mm-hmm.
Okay.
Who is teaching the fundamentals of skiing. And it's a very fascinating process. So it starts indoors, believe it or not.
Okay.
Starts indoors with getting on the ski boots,
mm-hmm.
maneuvering the environment with the ski boots. Ski boots are boots like no other, apparently. And once that gets oriented, once there's a comfort level there, they make their way out to the slope. And they're walking around on the snow, on the ice, wearing the boots. There are no skis, there are no poles, just the boots and the two guides.
Mm-hmm.
And eventually, the comfort level is strengthened, and they get one ski, and they do a little bit of routine with that ski. Once they graduate to the next level, they get the other ski to make four pair. And they get their poles, and they are beginning to form circles and make slight pathways to make it up to the lift and eventually a higher elevation. But I was utterly impressed with the precision, with the care extended by these volunteers.
That's amazing. I love it. In the few events that I've joined you for, I always was impressed with, you know, just the excitement to learn if they didn't know quite what they were doing or how to do it, but just to be there in the moment and be with those that you're serving was amazing. So you do have the best.
Thank you.
Absolutely. Can you tell us a little bit about how you got involved with Columbia Lighthouse for the Blind?
Sure. So next month, February, will mark my 13th year at the organization. And I came in 13 years ago in an entry-level position. It was administrative assistant position there in the D.C. office. And I just finished a few years working on Capitol Hill here in D.C., and I wanted to do more hands-on service, philanthropy, working directly with individuals. And with my own visual impairment, there was an even greater motivation to have that alignment with our mission with such a noble cause.
Sure.
And shortly into my entry-level position, there was an opening in the marketing department, and I applied and was hired. And at that time, marketing was more, exhibits, the conventions, and everything was print mail or either phone calls. I also was responsible for developing the volunteer program to what it is today. And it was remarkable being on the ground and working closely with our children's department at that time, working to recruit volunteer camp counselors and leading alongside our program director as they hosted camp after camp after camp. And now seeing those youngsters who are 17, 18 years of age. So I've had a terrific experience there and have learned so much from colleagues and clients and continue to be inspired by the mission and certainly motivated to move it forward.
Amazing. I know, so you're mentioning camps, we're talking about skiing. Can you kind of tell us what a year of work looks like at Columbia Lighthouse for the Blind? What kind of does a season look like, I guess?
Sure. So I will talk a little bit about this season. We're in the first quarter. We are about to embark on our annual art exhibition. It will kick off on Wednesday evening, March 14th, here in D.C. at Bus Boys and Poets.
Yay!
For all of you listening, you're more than welcome to come out and join us and to celebrate this exhibition opening. We're so excited to be partnering with them this year. For those of you who may not know, Bus Boys and Poets is a terrific community restaurant, multiple locations. I think there are 7 locations now, and we are thrilled to work with them to showcase the abilities of our clients, these artists who have varying degrees of vision loss. This year, we will host the exhibition for 3 months. Nicole, this is the longest exhibition we've had since the art exhibit debuted in 2015. And we are delighted to empower the community, to highlight our cause, our mission. And at the end of that period, we will get into our summer youth period. But before that time, in May, we will host our annual golf tournament. And Nicole, we are so excited that you were with us for both events last year.
I was.
And in May, our golf tournament, May 21st, more details are online, our website, clb.org. We will return to Woodmont Country Club in Rockville. And the highlight of the event is that 3 world champion blind golfers grace us with their presence, with their talent. And they are there to inspire individuals who are sighted. In many cases, they play at least a round of like a hole with an individual or with a foursome that is primarily maybe like sighted. And the talent that these gentlemen exhibit is just, is breathtaking. And at the conclusion of the 18-hole tournament, clients who are new to the sport of golf are introduced to the fundamentals of golf, putting, chipping, swinging, by these individual world champion golfers. So it's an incredible day.
It is.
So excited. This is our 6th annual. It's obviously a fundraiser, but the proceeds benefit our programs and services. So it's a great way for people to come out, to be inspired, to learn more about the organization, to network. The evening will be included with an auction, a silent auction for folks to cruise and get really cool gifts. And there will be a dinner and just a time to celebrate the day's accomplishments.
Amazing. So amazing.
Yeah. So, and then, so that's first quarter, second quarter, and then our summer season of camping. We have our annual summer camp for youth ages 6 to 12 occurring at the end of June.
Cool.
And then in July, we have a multi-week program for our teens where they will be housed on campus of Catholic University. And they will have internships during the day. And at night, they will have workshops where they will learn about job readiness, resume writing, where they will gain more confidence and the skills needed to have greater success in their internships. They will also have just social time to interact with each other. And it's a great, great experience. Yeah, we look forward to hosting it. It's a really good opportunity also for internship site supervisors to, in many cases, be introduced to our community. And last year, we had a great experience. A lot of new internships welcomed us into their agencies, and we look forward to continuing those partnerships this year.
So you are speaking specifically to businesses around Washington, D.C., who are taking on Columbia Lighthouse for the Blind members, community members, to gain skills and join them. Is that what it is?
Absolutely. So I am, you know, calling upon our business leaders, our companies to host, to consider hosting a summer intern, a high school student for a few weeks over the course of the summer to help with projects, to help with filing, to do research. These students are compensated for their time by us through the state agency funding.
Awesome.
And they are trained on how to travel independently to their internship sites. They bring their lunches. They are very independent. They are eager to be there, willing to learn, and willing to share what they know to these individuals on their internships.
So Columbia Lighthouse for the Blind is really creating a fantastic and amazing community for people who have vision impairment, who have vision loss, who may be completely blind. Why is it important to do that?
Nicole, this may sound surprising to you, but in the year 2018, there is still a lot of uncertainty, unfamiliarity with our organization, with our cause. People don't quite understand what blindness is, what a visual impairment is, what does that look like? There are still a lot of questions out there, and we are working diligently to elevate our cause and to dismantle any archaic thoughts, to eradicate those barriers to entry within the workforce, so that more and more individuals who are blind or visually impaired will be employed, will have gainful employment, and that we can continue to elevate our mission and to appeal to new businesses, to serve more clients, and to do it through partnerships, working more within the community of optometrists, ophthalmologists who are meeting individuals who have diabetic retinopathy or who have glaucoma. And these patients may not know about Columbia Lighthouse for the Blind, or they may not know that there are services, adaptations that can help people overcome challenges. They may need to know about adaptive technology so that they can stay connected to family and friends and get the skills that they need to gain employment, to succeed in the workforce.
Amazing. What do you think? I know when I talk about my world of living with one limb, there are many misconceptions that I want to talk about, but what do you think is the biggest misconception that you wish that people would understand?
The biggest misconception, in my opinion, is that one size fits all.
Mm.
If you're blind, you see A. If you're visually impaired, you also see A.
Mm-hmm.
I don't think the general public is aware that diabetic retinopathy is the leading cause of blindness among working age adults. And people who have diabetic retinopathy may have challenges navigating or seeing certain fonts. Age-related macular degeneration is the leading cause of blindness among senior adults.
Mm.
I don't think that those statistics, I don't think that that clarity is there within the general public. I think when people hear that someone is visually impaired, oh, well, they can wear glasses and it can be corrected, or if they're blind, they see nothing, and it's a lot more complex than that. There is a great opportunity for continued education.
Amazing. You said, I think that's great. What technologies are out there that exist that help? What possibly is being worked on for the future in technology, specifically for sight? What's going on in the tech world?
So I will admit that I'm not the technology specialist out there. We do have a guru on our staff, Vincer Cotton, who's our Senior Director of Rehabilitation and Technology. And he's up to speed on all of the latest and greatest devices that can certainly improve the independence of an individual in the community. But just a general overview, there remain independent technology for screen reading, screen magnification, portable devices. There are a plethora of apps that will share information with people who have varying degrees of vision loss, apps that may indicate the color of a thread, a garment, which has obvious benefit. There are also portable handheld devices that may do a similar task. There are money identifiers that are portable that you can have, as well as apps via phones that are readily available and accessible for individuals. So
Amazing.
technology has progressed immensely and has impacted and improved the quality of life for individuals with vision loss.
Amazing. I don't know if you can see it or not, Jocelyn, but I've put Columbia Lighthouse for the Blind's website at the bottom of the page. I just don't know if you see it on your side of the screen. But that's what people can see. I think that's just because you're a guest in the specific room that you're in. But so if for those of you who are watching, if that is a resource in which you would love, yet again, here's the website. This is the place where you can go to find these resources and these amazing people, like Jocelyn, who's working so hard every day to do these amazing things. Jocelyn, am I missing anything? Is there something I didn't ask you that you're burning to talk about before I respectfully try to be kind to your time and let you go?
Well, I really want to just talk a little bit more about how you get involved. Nicole, you mentioned the
Sure, yeah.
website. That's the right place to start, clb.org. We are on most of the social media platforms. If you want to get engaged, follow us on social. If you want to receive newsletters, you can go to our website and directly sign up and input your email address to receive the monthly newsletter, as well as other electronic correspondences, because there is a lot happening in our community locally, and we have a lot of resources to share that can help people who may live outside of the DC region.
Amazing. Thank you so much for all the work that you do, and thank
Thank
you so
you.
much for joining me tonight. I was telling Jocelyn I'm going to be making many trips to DC over the next, over the next six-ish months. I'll be sneaking my way in. So I will be at Busboys and Poets, and
Yay.
and hopefully maybe timing will magically work out. I'll be able to join you again at another event. But yet again, thank you so much for spending your evening with us. We certainly appreciate that. And yeah, and have a great rest of your night.
Oh, thank you. It's been a pleasure, and we look forward to seeing you soon, Nicole.
Sounds good. Thanks for joining us here. And thanks again to Public House Media for allowing us to be on their channel. Good night.